going to talk about this soft glue and effective coupling. This is work that published already with Stefano Catani and Massimiliano Grassini, and also work in preparation with Simone Devoto and Javier Masitelli. So when Giancarlo invited me to give this talk, I realized that it could be a bit complicated in the following sense, because there are many QCD experts here in the field, so I will try to be a bit technical to give some of the details, not too many, but a few. There are also some people working on QCD, but perhaps not so much on reformation, so I will try to be not too technical. And for those who are not working in QCD, I will try to give some more general introduction. So my feeling is that in this talk, I'm going to disappoint all of you in different senses, but okay, it's a virtual talk, so we are all expected to be somehow disappointed and do something else in the meantime. So the idea is the following. I will spend some time in introduction about PQCD, where the P has two meanings. One is perturbative QCD, the usual one. The other, I think, is more modern, which is precision QCD. I will try to emphasize the relevance of having precise QCD calculations for colliders. I will talk a bit, some introduction about resonation, and then I will move into the definition of the soft glue and effective coupling at the lowest order, give some examples, and then expand a bit on some recent results on higher order corrections and a particularly interesting conformal relation that we found, which is valid to all orders. And then I will present my conclusions. So for the introduction, I always like to show this this very nice figure, which collects a number of measurements at the LHC over the last decade, more or less. And I think it's fair to say that the LHC has been incredibly successful in measuring a large amount of observables. You can see that they run for more than 12 orders of magnitude between the most copiously produced cross-section like sheds up to double-gauge boson production. Not only that they measure inclusive cross-section, that in many cases, like in the production of gauge bosons, TT-bar, there are also more exclusive measurements, like measurement of that particular object accompanied by up to 7 sheds, which is really impressive. And what is also very impressive is that when you compare to the theoretical calculation, which is the gray band, you see that there is an amazing agreement between the experiment and the theory. And in a few cases where you observe small differences, you tend to believe that this is mostly because of the lack of enough accuracy in the theoretical calculation, more like more than BSN. So I guess the summary for this would be that the standard model has been incredibly successful at the LHC over the last decade. But of course, on the other hand, despite of this success, we know that there should be physics beyond the standard model. And there are proposals, theoretical proposals for that. So far, we don't have any hint, any direct proof of the existence of the new particles that appear in these scenarios. So I think it's also fair to say that the search for BSN physics is driven by the experiments now. And I would say that there are two extreme scenarios in order to discover physics beyond the standard model at the LHC or at any collider. One of them is the one we all would like to see, is that to find a new state, a resonance in some invariant mass distribution for which you can claim that you have discovered, given the significance, a new object. Notice that in order to discover something like this, you don't need very precise theoretical predictions. You need precise theoretical predictions later when you want to analyze, to understand the origin of that bump or resonance. But in principle, this is more an experimental search. On the other hand, the other possibility is that we don't see new particles because they are too heavy and they cannot be produced with a large number enough to see statistically a resonance in the distribution, but we could be looking for some more indirect results by searching for new interactions of particles. For that, I mean by measuring many distributions in a very precise way, and also computing that in the standard model in with the same precision, and then looking for small differences that we know that even if we are not able to produce these new particles, they will have some impact on the observables, because, for instance, due to virtual corrections. So in this case, we certainly need precision theoretical calculations in order to do a proper comparison. And if I would have to bet which of these two scenarios we are going to experience over the next 2 decades, I will go more with the precision case, even though it's not the the most interesting, if you want, or the most spectacular, is probably the one that will be we will have to follow for the next 15 or 20 years. And I would be I would dare to bet two of my salaries on that. Of course, remember that my salary is in pesos, Argentinian pesos, that by the time I have to pay, we would probably be able to buy a couple of candies only. But then you have to pay me in euros, your real salary. So it's a win-win situation for me. But it's clear that we need precision, and precision means something of the order of a few percent, really, experimental and theoretical accuracy. And probably the Higgs sector is the most relevant here because it's the less explored and also is the most suited in order to act as the gate to new physics. Now, precision means basically precision in QCD because at Hadron Colliders, QCD is everywhere. Anytime we look for something interesting in the final state, we have a QCD in the initial and in the final state, and mostly in every observable we look at. And fortunately, we know that any hadronic cross-section at the LHC can be written as a convolution of two quantities. The non-perturbative parton distributions, that is the probability of finding a parton in each proton, times the partonic cross-section, the probability that these two partons interact and then produce what we are looking in the final state, plus corrections which are suppressed by the energy, the typical scale energy of the process. Now, of course, in order to get precision for the hadronic cross-section, which is the one we measure, we need precision in the perturbative cross-section and also in the non-perturbative parton distributions, the ones that we cannot compute, but we extract by doing global fit analysis to the available data from all the experiments. And I will only flash one slide of that, the most recent I have seen, about which is the status for parton distributions at the LHC today. So this is a comparison between the three main groups doing fit analysis of parton distributions. And what is shown there is the not the parton distribution itself, but the luminosity for gluon-gluon, QQ bar, QQ and QC, they are all normalized to one of them. And what you see is that there are some uncertainty bands, the bands that are related to the uncertainty on the PDF due to the uncertainties on the data. And you see that there is a very good agreement between them. So that is very good. And also that the uncertainties are of the order of a few percent already. Okay, so this is something that still has to be improved, but certainly will improve by adding more LHC data over the next years into the fits. So this is going into a good direction. The other direction, of course, is the perturbative part. And we know we compute, we start every calculation with a fixed order calculation, say leading order, next to leading order. Today, we have many observables computed at NNLO and just a couple that already have reached NQ below. But there are many other things that you have to add on top of that in order to get the few percent precision. For instance, you need electroweak and QED corrections, which can reach corrections of the order of NNLO QCD ones. You need to add a parton shower in order also to have a better reproduction of the experimental conditions. Fortunately, we have gone very far already in this direction because of the possibility of automation. Most of the next to leading order calculations, even with parton shower, can be done in an automated way. And the other thing that we have also improved quite a lot is resummation. So how to improve these fixed order calculations in order to get better results. So let me say a few words about resummation. So the idea is that we have always start with a fixed order calculation. That means we assume that there is some level of convergence of the perturbative expansion, which I'm not going to discuss. We know that this is asymptotically not, it's not a convergent expansion, but anyway, in the first few orders it should be. Should provide a reasonable result. And this is based on basically two ideas. On the idea that we expand this in the coupling power of the coupling constant, so that means that the coupling constant should be small enough, which in QCD is not the case, it's of the order of more than 10%. So the convergence of the expansion is usually rather slow, but also is based on the idea that these coefficients do not grow very much order by order in perturbation theory. So we claim that they should be order one. So it turns out that for some cases, this is true, for some others that doesn't happen. And this is particularly problematic when one reaches kinematic situations close to the boundaries of the phase space because of soft and collinear emission and due to an unbalanced cancellation of infrared singularities between real and virtual contributions, these coefficients are contaminated, if you want, by logarithmic corrections. Logs of what? Well, typically you get logs of the ratios of the usual physical scales in the process. So if you have a process which that has two similar scales, E1 and E2 are of the same order, then you would get a log of one. Log of one is zero, so these coefficients will not become very crazy. But when you go to the boundaries of phase space, typically you produce kinematically, different, very different values for the scales of the process. I will show you a couple of examples. And when these two energies are very different, this log becomes very large, and then makes this coefficient very large. And not only that, it's even worse, the situation. It turns out that these coefficients at each order develop logs with a power that is twice the power of alpha s. So it means that if I go to alpha s squared, there will be a log of this quantity to the fourth. If I go to alpha s to the cube, this log will have a power six. And this is because there is one log, if you want, for the soft singularity and another for the collinear emission. So they really can spoil completely the conversions of expansion. I will show you one example now, but if you want typical examples where you need resummation, well, I will introduce resummation now, but where you have this problem is that if you look, for instance, at the production of a system with a small transfer momentum and a large invariant mass, I will show the example now, like Drellian and Higgs, the other relevant is threshold. When you are close to the partonic threshold, you have just enough energy to produce a heavy system, then you also produce large logarithmic corrections. And it turns out that in some cases, they completely destroy the conversion of the expansion. In some others, they make it worse. But in any case, you need to deal with that. And the way to deal with that is to resum these logarithmic corrections to some logarithmic accuracy to all orders in perturbation theory in order to improve the conversions of the perturbative expansion. So let me show you just one example, one clear example to show that this is not an academic issue, really. And a very simple example is Higgs transfer momentum. You produce a Higgs boson with a transfer momentum kT, the Higgs boson with a mass of 125 GeVs. The logs that will appear are of this kind, and you will see which is the effect. So what I'm plotting here is the differential cross section of a Higgs boson production with a transfer momentum kT. Okay. And you see two lines. This is the first order calculation, and this is the second order calculation. So you see that if you go to large transfer momentum of the order of the mass of the Higgs, then you see certain conversions of the expansion. The corrections are large. This is typically in QCD in Higgs production, maybe 50, 60%, but there is a reasonable conversions, if you want. But when we go to very small values of QT, much smaller than the mass of the Higgs, say below 20 GeVs, you see that the situation becomes completely crazy. The leading order result goes to plus infinity, the next leading order goes to minus infinity. And certainly this is a region where the conversions of the perturbative order calculation, the fixed order calculation, is just completely spoiled, and then you cannot trust it. The way to solve this problem is to reorganize your perturbative expansion. So what you do is, instead of organizing your perturbative expansion in terms of fixed orders at the level of the cross section, what you have to do is to resum all these large logarithmic corrections, proving that the emission of multiples of gluons in a Higgs cross section can be written to certain logarithmic accuracy as an exponential for the emission of, say, a single gluon times the Born cross section, the cross section for not emitting any gluon. And then you compute this exponent, this pseudo comfort factor. You expand this pseudo comfort factor at certain logarithmic accuracy. So if you want, you do expansion at fixed order here, and then you recover a new definition of a calculation that actually turns out to be very much convergent, in a sense that when you plot now the cross section after reorganizing all this large logarithmic correction in the pseudo comfort factor, you get something like this plot. You get that the first order and the second order also have now a very good agreement up to very small values of QT. And then you can trust your calculation in a region, in a kinematical region, where you find most of the events in this case. So it certainly helps to recover a level of conversions in your expansion. The other case is, as I said, threshold resummation. I will concentrate more on this. What we are looking at here is that the production of a colorless system with any number of colorless particles in the final state. I show here the example that could be Drellian, for instance, the production of dileptone pair, electron pair or the Higgs boson production. In any case, since it's a colorless particle, the only possibilities you have in the initial state is that you get QQR or gluon-gluon. So they are the two possible channels that can produce that. And we are interested in a kinematical situation in which the mass of the system, which is being produced here, is close to the center of mass partonic energy in such a way that you get these large logs. This variable set, if you want, is the measure of the distance to threshold. So when you get set close to one, then you are getting close to the partonic threshold. I don't want to get into the ugly details of the resummation, but I will need a couple of equations. So let me say that in order to perform the resummation, it is more convenient not to do it in using set space, but you're doing what is called Mehling space. It's simple, you just take the cross section and compute the this transform. Okay. The advantage is that by computing this transform, this Mehling transform, you can factorize the parton distribution from the partonic cross section, and then you concentrate only on the partonic cross section. And also that you get a better measure of the distance to threshold. So instead of log of one minus L, you get logs of one to a given power. So large N means that your process is getting close to threshold. Now it is very well known that how to write the resum cross section for this very simple observable because it's inclusive cross section. So the resum result in Mehling space is written as the partonic, the leading order cross section times a coefficient that takes into account virtual corrections. It's a coefficient that you have to compute order by order in perturbation theory and is process dependent. I will not discuss that anymore. But the most important part is that all the large logarithmic corrections are given by this quantity, which is again the Suda conform factor. And the Suda conform factor, I just show you because it has a very simple expression and I will use part of it for the rest of my talk. It has also expression like this one. It's just again a Mehling transform basically of a quantity and an integral over, let's say, some invariant mass or some transit momentum of two quantities, two functions, the function A and the function D. These functions are actually free of any logs. So all the logarithmic corrections are generated after these two integrals. So these two quantities are free of logs, and those are the quantities that you can compute order by order in perturbation theory, and then will tell you which is the logarithmic accuracy of your calculation. For instance, the coefficient A, which is the dominant one, is the coefficient which is related to the probability of soft collinear emission. So the emission of soft gluons that are also collinear to the initial state. And you can compute order by order in perturbation theory. And if you put the coefficient A1, that defines what we call the leading logarithmic accuracy. If you add the coefficient A2, you get next to leading log. If you add the A3, you get next to leading log and so on. At the same time, you have to add this coefficient D, which takes into account the emission of soft particles, which are not collinear. So soft particles at large angles, which only starts at second order. But I will mostly concentrate on this quantity A because it's very much related to the soft gluon effective coupling that I will discuss. This coefficient A is also very well known. This coefficient A is simply given by the soft limit of the splitting function. You take the splitting function, the Altarelli Parisi splitting functions, you take the soft part, the part that goes like 1/(1 - Z), and the coefficient of that quantity is what we call the cusp anomalous dimension. This is exactly the coefficient that goes into there. Now, one important thing here to notice is that the splitting functions appear there and also the cusp anomalous dimension because one has to perform at some point the factorization of the collinear divergences. And actually this is the reason why this integral has this mu f, the factorization scale. This is a quantity that if you compute it without factorization will give a divergency that you absorb into the definition of the parton distributions. So the origin is factorization of collinear divergences. And since factorization depends on the scheme one used to factorize that, the results I will be presenting here are always the MS bar scheme results. But what is important is that this is a quantity which is scheme dependent. It's not, if you want, a physical quantity. It's a quantity which is derived after performing the factorization of collinear divergences. Going back to the QT resummation, the formula for QT resummation is a bit more involved because when you produce a system with the transfer momentum in the final state, then you have more particles. And in order to reach a small QT, you can get that either by a soft collinear division, also by collinear radiation. But even though the equation is a bit more complicated, it involves a Fourier transform because you have to go from the QT space to the B space to the impact parameter space. The expression for the pseudo comfort factor is actually quite similar. The pseudo comfort factor, the quantity that takes into account all the large logs, also contains a function A, yeah, which also drives the soft collinear emission, plus another quantity which takes care of the collinear radiation. But you see, it's an integral which actually has a very well-defined limit. This is not divergent because when you look for a system with a certain transfer momentum, the transfer momentum will be a small QT, but it's still finite. It's different from zero. And this quantity is just the Fourier transform, basically, of the transfer momentum. So the question one might ask is, we get two analytical results for the summation, one for threshold, one for QT. Both of them contain this function A, which takes into account the soft collinear emission. The first question one might ask is, are they the same quantities? Since at the end, they are both driving the same physical mechanism, if you want. And it turns out that up to second order, they are exactly the same. So if you compute the coefficient A1 and A2 for these two formulas, they turn out to be the same. But the thing is that they are not necessarily forced to be equal because they have different origin, actually. As I told you, the one in threshold summation appear because of the factorization, the subtraction of collinear singularities, and therefore this is a skin-dependent quantity. While in QT summation, they are a physical quantity, in a sense that you measure QT, and therefore that introduces a cutoff in this integral, a physical cutoff, such that you don't need to absorb or factorize any singularities. So why are they, if they have a different origin, why they are the same up to second order? Well, the reason is that actually a calculation in the MS-bar scheme, if you do a calculation in dimensional regularization and you look for the divergences and then you factorize them into the Parton distribution, it's actually very similar to do a calculation by using a cutoff and QT. If you look at the divergences, the coefficients of the poles, which in one case will be 1/ε and the other will be log of QT, up to second order, they are the same. So they are equivalent. And because of this equivalence is that up to second order, these two functions are identical. But in principle, this is not true at higher orders, and actually we know that this is not correct at higher orders, and I will go back to that in a moment. We know that this quantity at three loops, which was computed by Becher and Neubert about 10 years ago, actually differs from this quantity at three loops, which is just the Kasper normal dimension. So this is concerning the analytical summation. Let me go to the soft gluon effective coupling. To another way to, if you want, is another way to resum large logs, but to do much more, which is doing or writing Monte Carlo for Parton showers. So which is the idea? The idea is that if you produce a system with many particles, you are calling principle very rough idea, of course, you can approximate it by the emission of, say, a number of hard partons plus a number of soft and collinear ones. And how do we approximate that? Well, you take into account that if you have a hard parton I, that could be a quark or a gluon, that will emit another gluon assuming that the probability of this emission is given by a collinear branching. So this is driven directly by the splitting function, okay, by the same splitting function as before. So basically what you approximate is that you say that the probability of this emission in the soft and collinear limit, which is called the double logarithmic accuracy, can be written as not as a full matrix element, but as the probability of emitting a particle, which is given by the splitting function, times some kinematical factors, which depends on the angle of the emission and the total momentum carried by the parton. That if you write it a bit more carefully, can be decomposed in this way. You get that the phase space and this one minus z in the splitting function provides you this quantity. This is an integral over the momentum of the parton, and an integral over the momentum of the QT. Each of these integral gives one single log. So what you get is that that gives the double logarithmic spectrum of the typical approximation in a Parton shower. And the quantity which is on top of that is a measure of the intensity of the soft gluon radiation. And this is actually, this intensity of the soft gluon radiation is what we call the soft gluon effective coupling, okay? At leading order, the intensity of soft gluon radiation is just given by this coefficient, this color factor. It's given by Ci alpha s over pi. Ci is the color factor. Is Cf if the emitter is a quark, because it's the color factor of this splitting function. is the color factory CA if the emitter is a gluon. Okay, so this quantity provides the lowest order soft gluon effective coupling. There is no magic there, it's just as simple as that. The question is how to extend that to higher orders. So how do you perform the resummation then in this case in a Monte Carlo partner shower approach? Well, you have two steps. One is very simple. If you want to just to resum up to leading log accuracy, what you have to do is just simply consider, instead of evaluating alpha S at the renormalization scale, you evaluate the running coupling at the QT of the momenta of the emitted gluon. In some way that resums all the leading logs by this evaluation. But most interesting, if you want to go beyond leading log, what you have to do is you have to take effectively the effect of extra emission. So this is also very well known from Catani, Marchesini, and Weber, like 30 years ago, that the way to effectively take into account next to leading log correction, at least some of them, this is achieved by a very simple replacement. You change this quantity, this soft gluon effective coupling at lowest order by a function now which is the lowest order one, plus a correction of order alpha s squared, where this correction is modulated by this quantity k, which is a very well-known quantity that also appears, of course, in the splitting functions. What is this soft gluon effective coupling doing? And this is probably the main concept here. What we are trying to do is to mimic effectively the effect, many effects, in one single coupling, in the single coupling of a physical gluon, but affecting this quantity here, the way the gluon couples to the emitter. And what you do there is basically the following. You take into account that at order alpha s squared, the corrections will involve things like not only emitting a single gluon, but could be a gluon that decays into two gluon, a gluon that goes into the QQR pair, and a gluon with a loop correction. So all these effects are effectively taken into account correctly in the soft collinear limit by simply replacing the coupling of a gluon to the quark or another gluon by this quantity, which is written here, okay? By adding this alpha s squared. It's very powerful because, of course, it allows you to extend the accuracy, if you want, of your Monte Carlo or your Parton shower by a very simply effective replacement, right? Now, the important point here is this is using Monte Carlo, dispersive approach, analytical resummation, and many other things. But the relevant, the key point is that this quantity, this factor k, is nothing but the same coefficient that appeared in the CASP anomalous dimension. So actually, the soft gluon effective coupling up to two loops is given exactly by the corresponding CASP anomalous dimension with the splitting function. So in principle, seems very, very like a temptation, knowing that we know higher orders of the CASP anomalous dimension, we have known for a while the three loop expression, and very recently the four loop was computed. One would be very tempted just to apply the same procedure to higher orders and just replacing the soft anomalous, the soft gluon coupling by adding these extra corrections. So the real question here for my talk is whether the CASP anomalous dimension and the soft coupling are still the same beyond two loops. And actually, again, the point is that this cannot hold in general for the same reason I told you before. This is a quantity which is related to the factorization of singularities into Parton distributions, so it's a scheme-dependent quantity, while this soft gluon coupling is a physical quantity. It's something that effectively replaces all the effects of the higher order corrections at the physical level. So in order to see whether these CASP anomalous dimensions actually provide the result for the soft gluon coupling at higher orders, or how to define that, you need an all-order definition for the soft effective coupling. Unfortunately, this all-order definition has been already provided in terms of what is called a web by Banfi et al. Like 3 years ago. A web is something like which is shown in this figure, if you want, just to simplify it. You take into account that one gluon of momentum k can produce a cascade, if you want, of correlated emission of gluons. Then you take into account all the matrix element square of this correlated emission of the gluons. You integrate over the phase space of all the extra gluons from k1 to kn. And you finish, as your result, you get a quantity which is called a web that depends only on the momentum of the initial gluon k. Okay? This is a proper definition. You don't need to get into the details, but it's just basically the emission of n particles removing the part which is not really correlated, okay, which is uncorrelated, which was computed at the previous order. So it's a well-defined quantity, and of course contains also virtual corrections. I will show you one example now. This is just one picture. But the important thing is that this is a finite, this is infrared safe quantity. So it's a quantity that in principle you could compute in four dimensions and will provide directly a physical result for the, almost provide the result for the soft gluon effective coupling. There is only one tricky thing. The tricky thing is that this depends on the momentum K of this gluon. Now, that in principle depends on four quantities. It turns out, of course, that any soft emission is boost invariant, so you can eliminate the rapidity out of that, and you turn out to have something that depends only on two, if you want, physical quantities observable, which are the transfer momentum of this gluon or the transfer invariant mass of the gluon, or what is the same, the virtuality. The other thing, as I said, this is finite. It can be computed in four dimensions, but for reasons that you will see in a moment, we prefer to compute this in D dimensions. And then we keep this epsilon here, where the D dimensions are 4 - 2 epsilon, okay? That you will see in a moment that, of course, you can set epsilon to 0 and you get the result, but you will see that you can gain a lot by keeping the D dimensional structure of this web. Now, as I said, this web is something that you can compute. There is only one issue to go from the web to the soft gluon coupling. And the point is that we are going to use the soft gluon coupling to make an effective approach. We are going to replace the coupling of a non-shell gluon to a given parton by then incorporating higher order effects. Now, the problem is that at lowest order, this gluon is, of course, on-shell. But when you go to higher order corrections to diagrams like this, this quantity will be off-shell. And therefore, you have to do something in order to adapt to the definition of one single on-shell emission. So as I said, this quantity depends only on two, the web depends only on the transfer momentum and the invariant mass, and the transfer mass. So given that there are two variables, we have proposed two definitions of soft coupling. The definitions are very simple. What you do, you take the web, which depends on these two quantities, you keep one of them fixed. For instance, you keep the value of KT fixed, and you integrate over the other, which would be the transfer mass, okay? And therefore, you get a quantity that depends only on the QT, and this is the scale you are going to use to evaluate, for instance, the coupling constant alpha s. There is no problem. And this is actually a definition that Banfi et al. Introduced 3 years ago. This is a very convenient definition if you are looking for QT-related observables. If you're looking for observables which are sensitive to the QT, to a small QT, then this is the variable that you need to keep unintegrated in order to apply it, for instance, to Monte Carlo or to perform the resummation. On the other hand, if you are interested in threshold-related observables, here the most important quantity is the transfer mass, and therefore you can do a resummation, a definition in which you keep the invariant mass unintegrated, so you have this delta function, and you integrate over the transfer momentum, and that will provide another definition of the soft gluon effective coupling, which in principle could produce different results. And you will see that this is the case. Of course, you can imagine infinite different scenarios in which you keep linear combinations of that integrated, depending on which is the relevant observable. But you will see that from third order, that also actually takes a place, takes an important place and will produce different results for each of them. So the thing then is that the web is exactly the same for all. The only change is can be produced after this integration. As I said, we can take the limit epsilon to zero safely to obtain the physical coupling, and we will do that. But it's also convenient to keep the d-dimensional definition such that we will expand any of these couplings. I will call T the coupling for QT and zero the coupling for threshold. So for any of these couplings, you will get a four-dimensional part plus some expansion in epsilon, and you will see how we can use that in a moment. So how do you compute that? I will show with some detail the calculation at the lowest order because it is simple. In principle, you have to look at, you go to, say, the emission of a number of soft gluons, You don't need to compute the full matrix element because you are interested only in the soft emission, in the soft limit. And in the soft limit, any matrix element can be decomposed as at least in these particular cases, when you have a colorless particle in the final state, as the Born matrix element times the square of the soft parton current. Let's say if you produce just one single gluon, the situation is very simple. This the matrix element that you have to compute for the web is just given by the usual Aconal factor. The Aconal factor for the production of a gluon with momentum K1 from partons P1 and P2. So this is very simple calculation to do. You write the phase space integration, which is also trivial for one single gluon, and you get what is called the web. So the web in the dimension is explicitly written here. So you see that there is a delta of mt squared minus kt squared. This is simply because when you produce one single gluon, this gluon is on shell. So k squared is zero. And therefore, when you integrate either over mt over kt, you are going to get exactly the same result. So all the couplings that you can define here, either for QT summation or for threshold, will be exactly identical to this order. And not only identical, they are exactly given by the color factor, CF or CA, times the function of epsilon. You need to remember this term. The only thing you need to remember is that, of course, that's with one, but there is no epsilon term. So it plays a crucial role that this expansion in epsilon starts for order epsilon square. And you can prove actually which is the reason for that. The reason is that this particle is actually on shell. Now, what we did is to compute the coupling, both couplings actually, to the next order, to order alpha s square, just to check, for instance, that this is exactly what Catani, Marchesini, and Weber found many years ago. So in order to do this calculation, I will not go into the ugly details, but you have to take into account two different types of contributions. You have to take real contributions, so that the gluon emits a QQR pair, or two gluons, and the virtual corrections. In the case of the real contributions, if you want, this is the most complicated part. Again, you can use the soft expansion for this emission. And the soft results, they are written here just to have a look of that. They are completely finite, of course. The divergences will appear after doing the integration over the phase space of these two extra gluons. So we are going to get up to one over epsilon squared terms in dimensional regularization that will cancel with those arising from the virtual cross-section from the loop. The integral of phase space of the loop is trivial because you emit a single gluon, but the one loop soft gluon carrying itself contains a poly structure. So you add all of them and you get the finite quantity. But in any case, as I said, we did the calculation not to order alpha s square, but to all orders in epsilon at alpha s square. And I will just flash the result. It looks very ugly. So as I said, the web is identical. The differences between AT and A0 arise when we perform the integration over the either KT, QT, or MT. Okay. They look very ugly. There are poles here, but this is a finite quantity, okay? If you look at that, even though it doesn't look like that, they are both finite. And actually, just to show you the result, if we do an expansion up to order epsilon squared, this is how they look. Both of them and in four dimensions, they are exactly given by the Kaspar normalized dimension at two loops. So that gets the result by Catani, Marchesini, Weber. But starting from order epsilon squared, you start to see that there are small differences between AT and A0. They develop because of the integration over the corresponding observable. So already at order epsilon, we have differences which, if you look in more detail, they are proportional to something like beta 0 times something else. So why do we care about the d-dimensional quantity when it is well defined at four dimensions and the physical the physical effective coupling is given by the four dimensional one? The reason why we care about the d-dimensional is that we find a very nice relation between all these couplings, which tells the following. It looks very funny at the beginning, but it says something like this, that if you take any of this soft gluon, any definition of this soft gluon effective coupling, either for transfer momentum or for threshold or for any of them that you can define, and you compute that in d dimensions, d equal to 4 minus 2 epsilon, and then you set epsilon equal to the beta function of alpha s, you get this very nice conformal equation, which tells that all these couplings are exactly the same, these soft gluon couplings, And not only they are the same, they are exactly given by the CASP anomalous dimension. Okay. What is so relevant about this particular value of epsilon equal beta alpha s is because this is a conformal point. In D dimensions, the running of the coupling constant in QCD is given by this quantity. In a sense, the beta function in D dimensions acquires an extra minus epsilon term. So when you set epsilon equal to the beta function of alpha s, you get that there is no running in QCD, that the coupling constant is frozen, and then you get into a conformal point. I'm not going to tell you the details about how we found this result, but basically what you did is we have a definition for the soft gluon effective coupling. We know how to do the resummation for threshold analytically. So what we did is to compare these two frameworks in D dimensions, and from there extract which is the value of the leading coefficient of that has to be factorized into the Parton distribution, which is given by the CASP anomalous dimension. So we can discuss later if you want a bit more of the details, but this is a quantity that we have find a way to prove it, but we believe that there are probably other proofs, perhaps using some dispersion relations, because this particular conformal point is very peculiar, okay? So there must be other ways to approach this result. Now, of course, it's difficult to prove that for one given observable, to prove that this is correct, because then you will need, I mean, the idea is that this is valid to all orders in alpha s, okay? To all orders and order by order. So you can do this proof order by order, and we have done up to the order we were able to compute, but we wanted to have a better hint of this proof to all orders. And there is a case in which you can prove this conformal relation to all orders. So you cannot do it in general, but you can do it if you look at the leading NF terms. So the terms that appear with the highest power of NF at each order in perturbation series. Why is that? Because they are very simple, because there are only two ways to get leading NF terms in a calculation. One way to do that is by inserting these bubbles, okay? Each of these bubbles will give an NF. And insertion means really the product of one after the other, so not interference between them, if you want, almost uncorrelated. And the other way to get leading NF corrections is by looking at the leading order result after normalization. So there is no NF here, but there is NF in the beta function. Now notice that this is a geometrical series, and this is just the product of a number of terms, which can also organize the geometrical series. So in principle, you can compute every order in alpha s for this leading NF terms, and also sum the perturbative expansion to all orders in alpha s. So we have done that. We have found an unordered expansion, see, and sum the series. This is work that we are doing now also with Simone De Botto and Javier Mazzitelli, and we hope to publish that soon. But what tells the conformal relation, and we have proved that explicitly, is the following, that if you compute this any of these couplings, okay, and you set epsilon equal to minus beta zero alpha s, where beta zero means only the NF part of beta zero, they are the same, and not only the same, they are exactly the CASP anomalous dimension, or the leading NF term of the CASP anomalous dimension, which is known to all orders in the perturbation theory in alpha s, was computed by Beneke and Brown many years ago again. So this is, if you want, the first proof that at least for one quantity that can be computed to all orders in perturbation theory, that this conformal relation actually holds, even though we have an explicit proof of the relation. Okay. So just another use for this conformal relation, and let me show you that can be actually quite useful, is the following. So the conformal relation is this. Let me give you just a hint of that. If you replace epsilon by the beta function, since the beta function starts with minus beta zero alpha s, any term which contains epsilon will become a power of alpha s, actually higher order than the one you computed, okay? For instance, if you did a calculation of order alpha s, this epsilon will provide another alpha s, okay? At least from here. So this equality, since we know the CASP anomalous dimension up to four loops, this equality can be used to compute the four-dimensional part of the soft gluon coupling by profiting from this particular conformal equation. Let me show you a very simple example. Let me write any of these quantities, AT or A0, to order alpha s squared. Okay, so we have alpha s over pi, the CASP anomalous dimension, plus some order epsilon term. Okay, there will be extra terms, but you will see that they are not relevant up to this order. And the alpha I squared, that is the corresponding soft Luon coupling at order alpha I squared. Suppose that we don't know the soft Luon effective coupling at order alpha I squared, which is this quantity. What we can use is the following. We can take this quantity, set epsilon equal to minus beta zero alpha s, and then equal that to the Kaspar anomalous dimension up to order alpha s squared. And from there, it's just a simple equation that you can pick up, which is the value of this soft Luon coupling at second order. The soft Luon coupling at second order is given by the Kaspar anomalous dimension at second order from this equality, minus this beta zero pi, this quantity that comes from here, which is the epsilon term of the one loop calculation. Now, as I told you, the only thing you need to remember from this one loop or leading order result is that there is no epsilon term. So because there is no epsilon term, is that the soft Luon effective coupling at second order is exactly equal to the two loop Kaspar anomalous dimension. Okay, but this is not true to higher orders. At higher orders, there will be other corrections that will spoil this identity. And actually, I can show you here in a moment. And this is the a point where using this conformal relation is actually quite useful. Because if you want to get A3 now, A3 for transfer momentum or for threshold, in principle, you will have to do a strictly this calculation. You will have to compute all the contributions that are order alpha s cubed. And that involves three different configurations. You will have to include triple soft emission. You have double soft emission with one loop and single soft emission with two loops. It's a very complicated calculation, of course, that can be passed by using this conformal relation. Because now, if we do the same, we keep up to order alpha s squared, and we need only up to order epsilon squared, because that will produce alpha cubed terms, you get this very simple relation. For any of these observables, that means QT or threshold, the soft Luon effective coupling is given by the Kaspar anomalous dimension, plus corrections which are related to the epsilon squared term of the one loop, plus the epsilon term of the two loops. Since we have this computed to all orders in epsilon, it's just a matter of replacing there and obtaining the corresponding quantity. And since this quantity particularly is here, remember that this is the epsilon term of the two loop. Is different for QT and for threshold, then the soft Luon effective coupling will be different for QT and threshold starting at three loops. And this is actually the result. The result is that for QT resummation, the set order soft Luon effective coupling is given by the Kaspar anomalous dimension plus these extra terms. And this agrees actually with the calculation by Banffy, but not only with the calculation by Banffy, agrees exactly with the coefficient computed by Becher and Neuber in order to produce QT resummation analytically. So this is a good check. And we obtain a new result, which is the quantity for threshold resummation. They look similar, but notice that, for instance, these pi squared terms are different, okay? So there is a difference between the transfer momentum soft Luon effective coupling and the threshold resummation soft Luon effective coupling. Now, this is a bit beyond, but for the particular case of threshold resummations, we have better control today of threshold resummation because the resummation is simpler than for QT. For threshold resummation, we are able also to find the soft Luon effective coupling at fourth order. And at fourth order, the soft Luon effective coupling is given by the for loop Kaspar anomalous dimension plus a bunch of these terms. Terms which are still obey Casimir scaling in a sense that this coefficient CI, they are exactly the same for quarks and gluons. The only thing that changes is the coefficient CI here, which is CA for quarks and CA for gluons. That is not true for the Kaspar anomalous dimension. The Kaspar anomalous dimension does violate the naive Casimir scaling, has a different scaling. But if you want to see numerically, this is the value, the numerical value in powers of alpha s, of the soft Luon effective coupling for threshold resummation up to fourth order. And you will see that they are identical for quark and gluons up to here. And then there is a small difference for quarks and gluons in the coefficient because of this violation of Casimir scaling in the Kaspar anomalous dimension. But the violation is very small because it turns out that actually all these terms, this bunch of terms, numerically are more relevant than the Kaspar anomalous dimension itself. So it turns out that that dominates numerically the result for the soft Luon effective coupling. Of course, we started with a very simple process where there are only two hard partons in initial state. When there are processes involving several hard partons, the situation is much more complicated. You need to account for the extra soft Y-angle emission and collinear radiation, which is not included here. But in any case, the soft gluon coupling AI, those we presented here, they are not affected. They are still a physical measure of the intensity of soft collinear radiation from a given parton I, okay? And for the case of threshold, they are now exactly up to fourth order, for QT resum to third order. And if you are looking for another observable, which is none of them, probably you can also, actually, you can also compute that given a proper definition of the most relevant variable. The other thing, I'm finishing here, but the other thing I didn't discuss, which is also very interesting, and we are working on that, is that even though this coupling AI in four dimensions only takes into account the intensity of soft collinear radiation, when you look in processes like Drellian or Higgs boson production, if you look not for the four-dimensional coupling, but for the d-dimensional version, that takes into account all the terms that you need to perform the proper summation. So it also takes into account the possibility of large angle emission and also provides the right structure to obtain the hard coefficient, the loop coefficient for the process. So it's actually a lot of information provided in this d-dimensional version. So just to conclude, I try to give you a definition of the soft gluon effective coupling in higher orders. Actually, you see that there are many definitions starting from, I mean, there are many definitions at every order, but they start to be relevant at third order. I provided explicit results up to NNLO, and in the case of the soft gluon coupling for threshold-related observables, that goes up to NQLO. And probably a very interesting situation that we are still investigating, and it's could be interesting to look more in detail, is this particular conformant relation, which is valid to all orders between the soft gluon effective couplings and the Kaspar anomaly, as I mentioned, at this particular conformant point. And of course, this is just one step towards improving the precision of parton showers. That provides, if you want, the first part that you can use in improving the precision or improving the logarithmic accuracy of the precision, which is fundamental in QCD, not only for LHC, but also for future colliders. So I think I can stop here.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Thank you. Really interesting. I disagree with your guess that I like it very much. So I have a few questions, but maybe from the audience first, we can have a question. Yes, Gennaro, please.
Yes, a simple question. So as far as I understand, all this business concerns the A function in the resummation, so both soft and collinear radiation, while in principle, if we want to put on the same footing all the terms in the pseudo-conform factor, we should develop something similar even for functions B or D concerning soft, large angle, or hard collinear emissions. Is it correct? Or?
Yeah, it is correct, but actually, as I said, at least for processes like Drellian or Higgs, I mean, when you produce a colorless system, which is a simple case, and you get this D function, the information is already there, actually. And you are the expert, so you will see it. You see it here, right? If you look at that, if you remember, this is basically the D function, apart from some pi square corrections. So actually, in the epsilon terms of the second order of the coupling A2, there is information about the D function at the next order. So we think that at least for processes like Drellian, probably everything will be, everything is actually included in the D-dimensional version of this object. So that part in principle can be done. Of course, if you have more hard partons in the final state, then yes, you need to develop the same kind of framework for the collinear emission and for the large angle.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you have heavy quarks, probably The D function also should work for, let's say, soft wide angles, something like that.
I think so.
You, for heavy curves, you don't have the collinear singularity, right? So you should deal with soft wide angle at, let's say, subleading order, and it should work since, as you just said, the D function corresponds to this correction to A03, right?
Exactly. And I think it's one could say that in the D-dimensional version of this quantity, all the soft information is there, not the collinear one, not the just collinear.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
No, thanks.
We have a question from Marco Bonvini.
Yeah.
Marco.
Hey. So now, related to this point, you said that the D function information is included in the epsilon dependence. But the question is how to use it. I mean, are you saying that if you construct like a Barton shower with those effective couplings, somehow keeping the D dimensions, you can recover the result of the analytic resummation, or do you mean something else? Yes.
No, I mean, explicitly, if you keep the epsilon dependence and you you exactly reproduce the analytical result with the D function, that's true. The question how to use in the Monte Carlo is a different thing, because you don't want to write the Monte Carlo in D dimensions. So well, I guess not. So that is a more complicated part that requires, I mean, we haven't looked at that in detail, but in principle, it's the usual stuff, no? You improve your accuracy and your soft gluon effective coupling that pushes a bit the accuracy of your Monte Carlo, but not completely, because you still need the other parts. So this is something that we haven't looked at that in detail.
Okay. May I ask another question?
Yeah.
So if I understand correctly, at the end of the relation, the fact that when you set epsilon equal beta, you get the cusp is still conjecture, despite the fact that it works up to a rather high order, and it works to all order in the large NF limit. But after that, is it?
No, it's not a conjecture. We have a proof. We have a proof for that.
You have a full proof.
Yeah, we have proof.
Okay. Sorry.
We have a proof that we did for threshold summation, but we found that it's also possible to extend it for QT. So in principle, that should be valid for any of these quantities. But we have a proof. What I believe is that there are probably other proof that could be follow or other ways to prove it, perhaps from the dispersion relations, but we have an explicit proof. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so in the meantime, maybe we can have other questions. I can ask a couple of questions. So, if I understand correctly, I mean, these differences are due to running coupling effect, right? Somehow, because at the conformal point, there are no difference in this definition of couplings. Mm-hmm. And so, if I understand correctly, this, let's say, threshold coupling differs from the A function of threshold resummation, right? But
yes.
What about this QT resummation? So they are the same. So the A function of the QT resummation is equal to the soft coupling, let's say QT soft coupling at all order, only the first few orders. So there is a relation between the these two functions or not?
You mean the function used for the analytical resummation?
Yes.
Well, we have computed up to third order, and up to third order, they are identical to the one we use in our code, for instance. Yes. But we haven't gone.
Okay. So they could differ from the fourth order, for instance. You don't know. So
I think the definition is such that it's the physical quantity and probably the only physical one. And since the for QT resummation, the coefficient of A is physical in the sense that it's not skin dependent and so on, this is probably true to all orders. But I'm not. We never compare the expression for the resummation using this effective soft gluon coupling with analytical resummation for QT. as we did that for Treasure, but not for Qt. So I guess that this is correct to all orders, but I don't have a proof for that.
Because in this sense, including this soft coupling in Qt resummation, it's a sort of change of scheme. So you are moving the effects from the Sudakov, from the A function, and you plug in the coupling. But It should be almost the same. I mean, it's sort of moving the higher order effect, but while in Monte Carlo, you can improve the accuracy. So I'm wondering if this coupling could add something on Qt resummation. And related to that, so you are able to compute this coupling to the next order or yet not? Because it seems that with the cusp at with the A4, you should be able to compute the A4 for Qt resummation, isn't it?
Yeah, there is one problem. I can show you here, maybe. If you go to fourth order, you will get a relation a bit more involved than this. So we get that the fourth order version will be equal to the fourth order cusp anomalous dimension. And then you will get a bunch of other corrections here. And among them, there will be the epsilon term of the three loop quantity, which we don't have. Because for that, you will need to do exactly this calculation up to order epsilon, and this is not available yet. So that is the only part that is missing, but the rest is available, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, so you can compute extra pieces of the A4, but not all of them.
There is one missing term only. Mm-hmm. Yes. We are actually looking, trying to find another way to get it, but it's not, okay, you cannot make magic, no? At some point, you have to do some hard work.
Okay. You know, if there are other questions, if not, I have all, again another curiosity. So you were saying that you have two different definitions because you have basically two kinematical quantities, but somehow there are only these two, or you can have a sort of mix of these quantities. So you can define a soft coupling, which is a sort of a combination of this, maybe not particularly clever, but somehow of this quantity.
There are infinite possibilities there if you want, yes. And you can modify that for each observable, yes. Mm-hmm. That's true. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. I don't see any other question from the audience, so let's thank Daniel. Gennaro, maybe?
No? Yes, just a short question. So concerning Parton shower, so you are ideally aiming at at generalizing the prescription of Catani Marchesini Web. So in principle, one could rescale alpha strong using this generalized function in order to include further subleading logs in the coupling constant, even in the Parton shower. So aiming at some NLL Parton shower algorithm, is this the ideal goal in the context of Parton showers?
Exactly. Of course, you are not going to get a full next to linear log by doing that, but you get some of the terms. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, and it also plays a role on the Dorchester Marchesini Weber model, no perturbative model, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Have you had a look on that or not?
No, we have a look. We know that it could be used there, but no.
Okay, so I don't see any other hands raised in the audience. So let's thank Daniel